This is Shoe Bob, Bob Ferguson. Putting up those zany storefronts at the shoe shop across the way. He's I'm sure. Did you see what's going on in the front row? Those aren't sunbonnets.
Thanks, guys.
Bob has a unique perspective of Highland Square. From over the shoulder of the mannequin, and he will tell you about that right now.
Thank you, Bob.
First of all, I've got to thank my friends here, who I told speech people have told people before when you come up before a crowd that it's helpful to envision them in their underwear. As Rosemary said, I'm the owner and sole proprietor of the Highland Shoe Repair. I've been for the last 17 years. Most of my customers would inform you that I'm never there. Usually, that's just before I'll ask them, what are you doing here? Well, I'm here to pick up a pair of shoes. Then I was here before in order for you to drop off the shoes, right? Okay, so I was here once. That's once it fits into your word or conception of the word never. I'm here now. That's twice. Now, as they're boggling with that information, I go look for the shoes, of course, only if they have their claim figure. But I'm digressing here. 17 years ago, when I first came to the Highland Square area, the complexion of the street was quite different. Next door, where the Walgreens is, there was a trolley stop restaurant. Prior to that, Crystal's, and way before that, Brown Derby. To the right of me, the Highland Square Theater has had four such managements. It's Alonzo Reed, Patty Eddy and Ron Sowery, Terry Dean, and currently Ted Bear, the owner of the building and my landlord. To the right of this, where the Square Records and Revival are located, there was previously a Motorola Beavers place, a basket shop. Further down the road, we had Doty's, Lily's, Summit Tailoring. To the far side of, well, before I get there, to the far side of what is now Angel Falls, which was then Martell's Tuxedo Clothing and Men's Stores, there was a Ripley's on the far side of Mary Coyle's. Now, 17 years ago, to put this in some sort of context, two top films that were on the screens at the time were Jurassic Park and Groundhog Day, both which had some sort of relationship to time. I happen to like movies. They use those as a perspective on relating other items in life, too. Two such that I wanted to touch on was The Time Machine in the 1960s and The Sixth Sense. Now, in The Sixth Sense, there was the young boy who saw dead people.
I see dead people.
The truth of the matter is, I see dead buildings, or more rightly, the ghosts of buildings that used to be. In a broader sense, in Akron, there would be places like just recently, the Wonder Bread Bakery and Thrift Shop on Mill Street, Tricasso's Pizzeria on College Street, Sokol's Fabulous Furniture, no longer there on East Market Street, the Bob's Big Boy on Talmadge Circle, Packard's, and the Bun Boy, where my grandmother worked next to the Corral and the Spotless Spot. We're sensing a hamburger theme, but this, of course, is Akron. Now, to put also in context, 1993, Bill Clinton was president at the time in his first term. The economy was robust, and we were well on our way to a national balanced budget. God, it seems like a long time ago. Now, in The Time Machine, a unique vehicle used by George Powell, where Rod Taylor was doing H.G. Wells, was that he was positioned at one point in a time machine across the street from a dressmaker shop, which coincidentally enough had a mannequin in the window. The vehicle for using time travel was elapsed time mannequin clothing changes that you and I would know had happened through the course of history, but were new to Mr. Wells. To be perfectly honest, in the 1960s, the robust economy was such that they imagined that a business would stay in place for a great length of time, two generations. We all know this isn't necessarily true, except for shoe repairs. And at the same time, we have to suspend disbelief, both for the movie and for shoe repairs. Now, unlike Mr. Wells, my perspective in time travel has been looking over the shoulder of a mannequin rather than looking at that mannequin. Across the street, I could see where Sparkle, which had turned into Star Market, and a Roadrunner video, which previously had been a Rite Aid, and before that, a Grey Drug, and the old West Hill Library. I'd seen pedestrian and foot traffic walking back and forth. I'd watched the buildings themselves crumble down into Highland Square's own equivalent of an apocalypse, and for quite some time looking out that window, there was a vast void. Then watching these buildings slowly rise back up anew, which was great to see. Buildings are much benchmarks in time as they are locations. I know, for example, that when directing people to come to my shop, that I was exactly one measured mile up from the Tangier restaurant. You know that place down the road that looks like a mosque? We were there. When people would come up from downtown, I would say, walk to the Tangier restaurant, 1 mile further, same side of the road, in between the theater and the Walgreens. The mannequin would be there waving at you as you come along. And that's 3 years how I would give directions. Until recently, a young lady calls me up and says, how do I get to your shop? Where are you coming from? I'm coming from the Akron University. Well, you go past Main Street, but what's Market? Well, I'm out past Tangier's restaurant. Where? Tangier's restaurant. I'm sorry, I don't know where that is. I was taken back for a moment, feeling my age, but I quickly recovered. You know where Chipotle is? Apparently now I have two demographically different directions depending upon whether or not a person is under 30 or over 30. Nowadays, we'll use that. But we notice how time, perspective, and landscapes have changed in order to get Highland Square. Just for the record, if anybody's been paying attention, you can tell others that I have been here all along. If you don't believe me, that's my mannequin.